Walker. We start today's news by speaking to Councillor Robert Nemeth about the Busgate saga by Valley Gardens. Here's the news story. So I'm here with Councillor Robert Nemeth for the Wish Ward from Brighton City Council. We're here to talk about Busgate, not Watergate this time, Busgate. Tell us what this is about. It's quite an interesting kind of traffic layout we've got here, and it's leading to a lot of people getting fined.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. So I've uncovered at the last meeting of the Council's Transport Committee that 9,600 people are being fined every month for driving through a series of so-called bus gates. This is one of them, around the Valley Gardens in Brighton. And that works out as over 300 a day, or you might think of it as one every 2 minutes. My argument is this device is designed to actually stop motorists driving past it. But just as we've been standing here, we've seen a number of people doing it. So it's clearly designed wrong. The council knows this. They've collected over £3 million now. So they clearly could have put a stop to it, but perhaps the fee that they're getting in precludes them from fixing it. And that's the argument that I'm making.
Public cars go along here and they have to turn up Trafalgar Street, but many are just going straight through onto London Road. Is that right?
That's right. So any vehicle coming up or coming down has to turn here, or they get a £60 fine, which is reduced to £30.
Yeah.
But the markings aren't clear, and I make the case that if an engineer wanted to fix this, they easily could, but they haven't done so.
As cars approach this this point, you're saying the signage isn't as good as it could be, and a lot of people are actually almost being tricked into going straight past into the Busgate area, thereby getting fined. You're saying signage isn't clear enough?
Yeah, it's not just about the signage, it's surface treatment, approach to the junction, the fact that a tall vehicle might be in front of you so you don't see the sign that's coming up. But essentially, it should be that everybody's told to turn off and buses and taxis would know not to.
Yeah.
So they don't need informing because they're professional drivers who just wouldn't do so. But it should be made very clear everyone's turning unless professional driver.
And there's bus gates all around the Valley Garden scheme, isn't there? So I mean, I think they've been around for quite a number of years, haven't they? It's not a new thing, a bus gate. It's in the highway code, apparently.
There's no problem with, I mean, Churchill Square
has a bus gate.
Entrance to Churchill Square is a bus gate. Nobody's complaining about there being a device that stops non-buses drive through.
It's just signage. So what could be done in a council level? I know there was quite a heated exchange, wasn't there, recently in Brighton Hove City Council?
That's right. Well, the Conservative group, of which I'm obviously the spokesman, made clear that this isn't acceptable. The Labour group and the Green group seemed to agree and then voted for it to continue. So we're in one of these bizarre situations where a problem's been pointed out, but those who are in power, which is the Labour-Green coalition, have not done anything about it. I'm saying it needs fixing, obviously.
Yeah, exactly. So what's the next steps then? What do you think can happen? I mean, it seems...
Well, the next steps are we'll watch the council letting it continue and we'll watch motorists just continually get ripped off.
Yeah. How much money has been raised in so far through these various bus gates? I think there's four around.
Yeah, well, it works out as £3.5 million pounds a year, and we haven't had a full year of it yet, so we're high fractions of that year.
Yeah, okay. And obviously you're going to be speaking to the council, so do you think it can be rectified? I think clearer signage, is that what you're calling for, really? Mainly the clearer signage?
If they're stuck on rectifying it, I'll happily submit a design, but it's easy peasy. It's easy to rectify, you just have to choose to do it.
Yeah.
Any traffic engineer would... It's like primary school stuff. Easy.
Yeah. Okay, we'll leave it there. Councillor Robin, thanks for talking to us today.
Thank you.
We now hear from Minnie Dobray, who walked down to the Brighton Hove Toy Museum to celebrate their anniversary. Here it is.
Hello, I'm just here with Chris at the Toy Ball Museum in Brighton, celebrating their 30th anniversary, so congratulations.
Thank you. I've been a collector all my life. So most of the trains you see here I bought since I was at school, basically, probably when I was 12. And I've been buying them ever since. And it is a disease, I have to say.
A good disease, yes,
absolutely. But collecting, you can't stop yourself. And it was all my home in Hove. And I got to a stage where I could hardly move for home. They were in the kitchen cabinet, they were under the bed, they were everywhere, literally. and I had a French lady friend who quite liked it, but she said, this is getting a bit silly. So, anyway, eventually we discussed it with various people that maybe we should do something constructive with all this stuff. And the idea was a gallery or a museum. But at Lewis, we looked all over the place, Worthing, all around, to see whether we could find something suitable. And one day we found a board outside the door, British Railways Property Board, premise to let. Yes, let's have a look. And that's how it started.
Here we are.
Here we are. And when I came in, I thought, oh my God. I looked up at the roof with all the peeling paint, and bits of brick coming out, and oh, it was in an absolutely appalling state. But with a group of us and a very good guy who became chairman, we set ourselves up as a charity and went through the mill to get to where we are now. And then it was nearly a year of really hard work. It nearly killed us.
Driven by so much passion, though.
It had to happen. Yeah, exactly. No, it had to happen.
So a lot of these toys are yours. Did you show me around?
Well, the trains in particular, but not those actually. These belong to a very, very kind gentleman who is involved with the museum. And these are his. This is here. We have almost a beautiful cross section of everything Hornby made. Now, everybody I think's heard of Hornby.
The craftsmanship behind how toys were made back then to now, do you think? Massively changed.
Oh, there literally is no comparison. Today,
really?
Well, today they stamp out plastic things in their thousands and thousands. These things were hand assembled, they had pressing machines which pushed out the parts, and then people, they had loads of boys and girls at benches in Carno, for instance, with these pieces, clipping them together. Then they used to spray paint them in a special paint area, and then they put these lines and things. They hand do those. So they're very skilled people.
So much love and attention.
Well, that's right. Every one of them had a degree of passion to it, whereas today it's just plump, plump, plump.
Why do you think that is? Why do you think
it's a whole
it's a
whole story. No, it's a whole different way of life.
Yeah.
It's a different way of life. I mean, I said the people you've had patience to do this, and they weren't paid much, I don't know.
If these are all obviously quite expensive to buy, the children playing them may be from one of the backgrounds.
Oh, absolutely. Yes, absolutely right.
How has it been during COVID not to ask, you know, the depressing question, but was that difficult this year?
Well, yes it was, and we had to close, obviously, during the lockdown. I came in here every day during lockdown, because I was self-isolated into my own, I had a workshop here, and I restore the models and repair them.
No,
yeah. Well, this is classic model railway, and you can just go on forever creating a model railway, because you've got to think of so many things, you've got the scenery, the electrics, the railway, how is it going to look real, would it be like this, or wouldn't it, you know, you've got to get it right, otherwise it looks silly.
Were you saying earlier how toys back in the day were sort of to train you for later life, so a lot of girls' toys would be geared towards,
that sort of thing. This here, I've numbered the mirror, so each area has its number.
Oh, nice.
So really, number six, bottom line.
Yeah, everything's so
beautiful. It's all metal, and wood grain painted. Beautiful, lovingly done. Extremely collectible and fabulous, and it is so collectible. Now this is a popular subject, always, and still very collective. Teddy bears, and teddy bears historically was made for children, but they're very collective, and some of them make crazy money.
Really?
Crazy.
These make crazy money.
Yes, one to another. In the big league. Oh yes, we're talking way into 40 of these. Now that beautiful bear was my dad's. That's my dad's.
Is it?
Yes.
Oh.
He had that during the First World War.
Oh my gosh, that's such a lovely story. It's in such good condition as well.
He's been slightly cleaned up, and his feet have been redone because the straw was coming out. But he's original. But it's like looking into the past, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. So I think it's interesting, what I'm starting to realise is that toys are not just for young children, because you were speaking about as well older women that collect gold.
No,
and And even this, it's more, it's just amazing to look at and enjoy for any age.
Well, yeah, that's collectible. Yeah. Yeah. Lots of people collectible.
Thank you for speaking to me today. That was lovely to meet you.
Thank you.
I really enjoyed it. Yeah. If you see tourists at home.
Different lights, yeah.
Yeah, I've walked past this so many times, I've never come in.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I've never
been
back.
You're good, yeah. I'm enjoying it. It's a pleasure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
That's it for the first half. Join me for the second half, where we'll be speaking to Councillor Vanessa Brown and Councillor Leo Lippman. Join us then. Welcome back to Native TV News. I'm Mark Walker. Now for that report from Councillor Vanessa Brown in the studio. Here it is. So back here with Councillor Vanessa Brown for the Hove Park Ward and Brighton Hove City Council. We're going to be talking about 5G masks, which are quite a divisive issue, aren't they? I mean, we kind of need them to get faster kind of, you know, phone connections and whatnot, but they're also a bit controversial. And what's going on with the one in Dyke Road at the moment?
Well, the residents have got together because the big telecommunications company wanted to put a lot of masts on the top of the flats right next to Dyke Road Park. And they had a big campaign to stop that. And they now would like to try and make that an area where masts cannot go in the future, because they feel it's very near the park or right next to the park and very near the schools like Cottesmore and Cardinal Newman. So there has been a big push to try and stop that area being used for masts. But they're working on it at the moment. They've just set up a petition.
What about the mask camouflage? And I know that Councillor Anderson McNair, your colleague, you know, Patrick, they're camouflaging masks. Is that something that can happen?
Well, it makes them look better, but it doesn't take away the fact that they're there, does it?
No, exactly. So, I mean, we were just talking off air about this, about that. I don't know, phone companies just put a mask on a tall building, or because you'd think that the landlord, the freeholder, would have to give permission, but maybe everyone would reject, you wouldn't have any telecommunications, so maybe there's a way that they can force their way onto the top of a roof.
Yes, I am
somehow.
Not sure of the exact regulations about it, but they do seem to be able to put them in places where people don't want them, which is a worry.
Yeah, which is extraordinary. Right? Yeah. Okay, moving on then, I know we've got pavements with the weeds on the pavements. That seems to be a particular issue in your ward, doesn't it?
It is. I mean, they've tried to clear the weeds more in the city centre, but in the outlying areas, it's really bad. The pavements have become completely covered in weeds, and then when it gets wet, they get slippery, and it's really quite dangerous. I mean, I was on the committee when it was decided to do away with using pesticides, which obviously is a good thing, but what Labour didn't do was they didn't put any alternative methods of getting rid of the weeds in place before they just decided they were not going to spray them anymore. And six men with a hoe across the whole of Brighton and Hove is not going to get rid of all the weeds in the pavements. So they really need to come up with a solution to try and improve it, because the state of the streets is just awful.
So what is that solution? Because they don't want to use weed killer with these pesticides in it. So do we know what other councils are doing?
Well, I think there are machines that will do it, that you, not exactly mow them, but I think they kill off the weeds. And so I think they do need to look at something very quickly to try and sort this out. Because, I mean, they were so high, some of the weeds as well.
Yeah, exactly. I think a lot of people resorted to kind of mowing their own.
Yes.
front patch of grass if they've got that. I know that happens in Patcham.
And it happens in Shirley Drive, and where people do that, it looks really, really nice.
So they're doing their own gardening now. Maybe that's what they want anyway, so that we all just...
We try to encourage it, I think.
Yeah,
yes.
Exactly, yeah.
It's like also some people have planted around the trees in the street, and that looks very nice too.
What about in conservation areas as well? Is that a particular concern?
Well, we have a problem at the moment in Woodland Drive, because for about 2 years I have been asking for the pavements to be redone on one side of the road because they're so cracked. Admittedly, a lot of it's been caused by people having building work done, and the trucks on the pavements have ruined the pavements. And for years I've tried to ask the council to go and check up on the building work and get the people who've caused the problem to reinstate the pavements, but sadly they don't do it. So the pavements were in a terrible state and really dangerous. So they have now just started to redo them, but unfortunately in tarmac, not in paving slabs, and the residents are really upset and have asked that the work stop, and they can have conversations with us, but I'm not quite sure what's happening at the moment. I was in constant contact with them yesterday about it.
What happens to paving stones? Do they just get tarmacked over, or do they actually replace the paving stones? Because it used to be this trend, in, maybe in the noughties, where I remember the famous Chris Eubank case where he actually paid to have paving steps. But how is that replaced nowadays?
Well, I mean, some people, when they've had building work, I know of one instance in Woodland Drive at the moment, where the householder has paid to have all the pavements replaced outside of their house, which is really, really good. But unfortunately, people don't like the tarmac, and it is a conservation area. And so we're just trying to get them to go back to paving slabs. But A, they say it's much more expensive, and B, the council say that it's quite difficult to locate paving slabs at the moment.
Right, okay, interesting. So another shortage.
And finally, we hear from Green Party Councillor Leo Littman about all things planning.
I'm here with Leo Littman, Councillor Leo Littman, a Green Party Councillor for the Preston Park Ward, and we're going to be talking about planning today, one of my pet subjects. I know it's going to be your pet subject as well, because you're on the planning committee.
I have the privilege of chairing the planning committee.
Yeah, and that's it's quite... Because you're not the only committee that deals with planning. I've spoken to your colleagues, there are other ones. I think the tech committee does a bit of planning, but just tell us a bit about what your committee does, what you're responsible for.
Well, first of all, the split is the tech committee, which I also sit on, determines planning policy. Whereas planning committee sits and determines planning applications that come before us.
So, and then what kind of stuff do you get involved in? Because not everything goes to planning committees.
No.
Just tell us what sort of applications you tend to deal with.
So something like 96-97% of applications are determined by officers. What comes to planning committee are what are called major applications. So that's all the really big ones with, you know, large scale developments, and also any minor developments that have been called in because either five residents or one local councillor has asked for it to be heard by planning committee.
Yeah. Recently, the local plan, was that something that your committee dealt with, the local plan, the city plan part two?
No, local plan goes through tech committee.
Was tech committee.
Because it's policy. But, I mean, you know, there is a lot of to and fro. So Councillor Martin Osborne was my deputy chair on planning. He is one of the co-chairs of tech. Councillor Mariana Ebel is now my deputy chair on planning. She also sits on tech. I also sit on tech. Yeah. So there's a lot of to and fro.
A lot of overlap, yeah. So what's come up recently then on planning committee? Why do you think it's one of the most important committees out of the, you know, all the committees we have on the council?
Well, it goes through, you know, we get all the really big stuff. So, for example, I mean, not particularly recently, but we, you know, the Lewis Road development on the Preston Barracks site, that came to us. The developments out of the marina came to us. What's coming to us in the near future, things like the Hove Station development, at some point in the future, Toadhall Valley, all of those have to come to committee because, in addition to being determined by professional planning officers, it needs democratic oversight from, you know, elected representatives of all the parties and independents.
Yeah, and it's quasi-judicial, isn't it? So it's the one committee where you don't vote down party lines, which is interesting to watch.
It's absolutely right, and it would be illegal to vote along party lines. You're not allowed to have a whip. You're not allowed. You know, you don't have pre-meets of which you would for any of the policy committees. We are being asked as individual elected representatives from all the parties or none to make informed decisions on the future development of the city.
Yeah.
And you know, it is. I find it very interesting. I enjoy sitting on planning on policy committees where you are working with your party colleagues to determine policy, but I really, really enjoy sitting in a room where my view is as likely to be swayed by a colleague from the Tory party as it is from my own party. That's different. That's us working properly together in order to make, you know, the best informed decisions we can for the city.
Yeah, I mean, what big applications which have obviously been decided, and what are the big ones that you've kind of worked on, the contentious ones?
I think... I mentioned it just now. The Preston Barracks was huge, and you know that site had been derelict for decades. A lot of plans have come forward in how to deal with it. There have been issues with various elements of them, and we have this problem in the city. You know, we are we're bounded by the sea on one side, the Downs, which is now a national park, on the other side. There's very, very little we can do. If we're going to develop other than going upwards. So, you know, land value in the city is very high, property prices are very high, so we keep coming up against this thing of, you know, how tall can buildings be? And best rule in the world, they are tall buildings. There's a lot of tall buildings gone up in that area. And, you know, there's resistance to that for valid reasons, but, you know, how long is that site going to be left vacant? You know, there is desperate need for housing, there's desperate need for an expansion of the universities. So, you know, those are the sorts of weighty decisions that we have to weigh up all the time.
Yeah, and we've run out of time. I really enjoyed that. So thanks for coming in, Leo, and we'll catch up again soon.
Yeah, absolutely. Cheers. I enjoyed it too. Thanks very much.
Yes. That's it today. Join me tomorrow for more of your local news stories. Goodbye.